Welcome to the latest episode of the Informing Choices mini-pod. In today's podcast, I'm going to talk about the future of food and how drivers are converging to suggest a very different food future, which in turn gives rise to multiple other changes. Calls for changes to our diets and how we produce food to help mitigate against climate change, to promote healthier lifestyles, reducing the risk of obesity, heart disease, and cancers, for example, and for reasons of animal welfare, are often promoted as a binary choice between the current norm and the interest group's particular solution. But what if, rather than a straight choice, we had other options to consider? Perhaps new approaches and new technologies represent the opportunity to add choice to our diet as consumers rather than reduce our choices. To consider how the food sector might evolve, let's explore a scenario of food production in 2035 and the critical underlying drivers. So what I'm going to do is take a look at, firstly, the new future of arable farming. Second, meeting the need for meat, plant-based and in vitro meat. Thirdly, tax as a carrot and stick. Fourthly, supply chains. And fifthly, land use and repurposing. So let's kick off by thinking about the new future of arable farming. We're in 2035, don't forget. And land use for agriculture has changed rapidly, with highly automated production processes characterized by robots for crop planting, crop harvesting, and soil management. Robotic systems underpinned by artificial intelligence maximize equipment availability and limit breakdowns. AI is used for data analytics, for example, in consumer demand forecasting and yield forecasting. Computer visioning is used for monitoring nutrition, water, and pest management of the plants. And there's automated distribution management. Urbanized vertical farms, both naturally and LED lit, are commonplace and occupy swathes of business parks and repurposed office buildings. Hydroponics is a type of horticulture and a subset of hydroculture which involves growing plants, usually crops, without soil by using mineral nutrient solutions in an aqueous solvent. There was initial focus on herbs and leafy greens, but by now, in 2035, we are increasingly seeing root vegetables, vine-based fruits and salad crops that require autonomous pollination solutions. Elsewhere, new combined commercial farming and residential buildings feature north-facing accommodation away from the sun, while the vertical farms face south to reap the benefits of natural sunlight. The two environments are mutually beneficial, with the crops extracting carbon dioxide from the internal atmosphere and emitting oxygen through photosynthesis. Water is recycled from the accommodation area to help irrigate the crops. With more food being produced within urban centres, there is also a positive impact through shorter distribution and supply chains. Meeting the need for meat. Let's start with plant-based meat. With concerns about animal welfare practices, a climate crisis driven in part by animal agriculture, and global public health concerns through meat consumption associated with obesity, heart disease, diabetes, and cancer, pressure groups and many consumers are looking for sustainable foods that simply cause less harm to the animals themselves and are kinder to the environment to produce. One such approach is plant-based meats, the consumption of which is predicted to continue to grow significantly. Plant-based meats are food made from plants that are intended to offer an alternative to meats made from animals, foods like bacon, burgers, nuggets, sausages, steaks. Some classic veggie burgers, for example, are made predominantly with vegetables and legumes, such as soya beans or lentils. And others, thanks to technological advances and creative preparation methods, use proteins and extracts from plants such as peas, soybeans, wheat, or coconut oil to truly mimic the taste, texture, and appearance of animal meat. By 2035, every 10th portion of meat, eggs and dairy eaten around the globe is likely to be alternative, says a report from Boston Consulting Group and Blue Horizon Corporation, who predict that alternative proteins could account for 11% of the market by 2035, compared to 2% in 2020. So let's look now at in vitro meat. Cultured meat, also known as in vitro meat, is a type of so-called artificial meat and is produced by tissue engineering technology and cellular agriculture. It is said that in vitro meat is real meat made without deforestation or taking a life. Processing typically involves extracting cells from an egg or living animal. Cells are then chosen based on their ability to produce the healthiest, tastiest, and most sustainable meat. The cells themselves are immortalized, meaning they can continue to divide and produce meat indefinitely. The cells themselves are fed with the same nutrients that an animal would need, letting the cells divide and grow. Harvesting happens about 4 to 6 weeks later, when the cells used to create the end product are processed using techniques like molding and 3D printing. Additional processing, extrusion cooking, utilizes temperature differences and pressure gradients to create a more fibrous, meaty texture. By only producing the meat we eat, there is no waste, no animal byproducts, and the process, therefore, has a smaller impact on our planet and avoids slaughter, the use of antibiotics or hormones to promote growth. Beef, fish, salmon, shrimp and tuna, pork and poultry, including chicken and duck, are commonplace in stores in 2035, and together with plant-based meats have reduced livestock farming to species maintenance and specialist breeds. The cultured meat market is forecast to reach nearly $3 billion by 2030, according to AlliedMarketResearch.com, on the back of growth in global meat consumption, which itself is projected to increase by 12% between 2020 and 2029. The World Counts report predicts that global meat consumption will reach up to 570 million tons by 2050. And it's this increasing consumption of meat and meat products that drives the market for cultured meat. Let's now look at the role of tax as both a carrot and stick. Governments can pull a number of levers to incentivize behavioral changes. UK fuel tax differential between petrol and diesel is one past example, and tax on sugary drinks is another. So in 2035, we see red meat produced from animals very much the exception and subject to strict licensing and regulation, and it's highly taxed. Red meat produced through in vitro processes is taxed at a slightly lower level, and other in vitro fish and meat and plant-based meat products escape sales tax. It's the carrot and stick approach to government driving consumer behavioral change. Let's now have a look at supply chain. The new ways of producing vegetable crops and meat has seen a switch to production in urban centres rather than the countryside. By 2035, we've seen farming become an activity undertaken on industrial estates and business parks. Networked producers and production sites have been established near to all the major conurbations as the balance shifts from rural to urban production. The producers work with food retailers using smart analytical technologies to share data to grow what the market wants, optimize yields and production, and optimize distribution. As farming becomes increasingly industrialized, different and new corporations have got involved as the digitization of farming and food production has gone mainstream. Ever-increasing volumes of data are used to add efficiency and effectiveness to the farm-to-table system. Distribution is now undertaken by autonomous electric vehicles, with the vehicles connected to the system to ensure that they're in the right place at the right time to optimize transportation of produce, minimizing costs and wastage. Let's now look at land use and repurposing. Land use has changed markedly up to 2035, leading to a radically different countryside in some parts of the country. Arable land use now focuses on producing crops for plant-based meat and cereals, the land no longer needed to grow salad, vegetable, fruit, and animal feed crops. There's been an increasing demand for crops to supply a growing market for biofuels. Livestock land has been subject to rewilding to support biodiversity and conservation. The wide-scale planting of indigenous trees and meadows have supported biodiversity and contributed to carbon absorption. And where livestock land has been taken out of production, government grants have been made available to landowners to cover the transition to the new reality. You know, radical change is likely to be in all of our futures, and food production and consumption is no different. But rather than the solution to, one, helping mitigate the contribution of livestock farming to climate change, two, promoting healthier diets and lifestyles, and three, creating new standards of animal welfare, being to ban meat production and consumption, we can use technologies to produce meat in new ways that achieves the objectives and continues to provide consumer choice. Thank you for listening. Do let your friends and colleagues know about the Informing Choices mini pod, and there'll be another episode along very soon.